Hello everybody. So in this lecture, we will be discussing about the practice questions for NEET Crash Course. Let us begin with the practice questions from the chapter Anatomy of Flowering Plants. The first question states, what is true about heartwood? Now you know that the secondary xylem that is put inside during the secondary growth, as the tree matures, and this is the trunk of the tree, and if you take this to be the wood that is formed, the central part of the secondary xylem becomes darker in color as it gets pushed towards the center. The elements get crushed, they get deposited with tannins and resins and aromatic substances, whereas the peripheral part of the wood is lighter in color. So this is called, the peripheral part is called the sap wood, whereas the central part of the wood, which is dark one, is referred to as the heartwood. So since it is wood, you know that it is the secondary xylem. So let us see what are the statements given with respect to heartwood. It does not help in water conduction, which is true. The central wood is only is very durable, but the tracheal elements, as I told you, have been damaged here and they are clogged. They are heavily deposited with resins and gums and tannins and aromatic substances. So they are not available for water conduction. That is true. It is also called alburnum. It should be alburnum, which is false, because the sap wood, the peripheral or the sap wood, is referred to as the alburnum, and the central or heart wood is referred to as the duramen. So it is more durable, it is resistant to microorganisms and insect pests, and therefore it is referred to as duramen. So the second statement is false. The second statement talks about sap wood. It is dark in color, but it is very soft. It is not soft, obviously. So this is also false. It has tracheary elements which are filled with tannin and resin. That is true. So the correct answer would be the second option. That is, the first and the fourth statements are true with respect to the central wood, that is the central secondary xylem, which is called the heartwood. Parenchyma cells are found in, now most of the seeds are made up of parenchyma cells because seeds are mostly involved in storage of food. You know that there is a lot of endosperm in some seeds, and even after the endosperm is exhausted, the seed leaves or the cotyledons will store a lot of food in them. So basically the storage tissue in the plant is parenchyma. Meristematic cells have. Now meristematic cells, one of the most important features that you have to remember is they're actively dividing cells. So if they're actively dividing cells, obviously they should have a thin cell wall. So having a thin cell wall without any intercellular spaces, the cells are compactly packed and they're constantly in division. So the correct answer is they have a thin cell wall and they do not have intercellular spaces. Now, if you look at the question 4, let us match the following now. The motor cells or the bulliform cells we had discussed in the synopsis, it is found in the adaxial surface of a monocot leaf. So it is isobilateral leaf. So bulliform cells, we had discussed that they are empty and large cells which are present, and which basically whenever they lose water, the leaf gets curled, and whenever they become turgid, the leaf opens up. It is a mechanism of water conservation in monocot leaf. Where do you see guard cells? Now obviously guard cells are a form, are a part of the stomata. These are highly modified reniform parenchymatous cells which enclose an aperture called the stomatal aperture. Lenticels also help in aeration. Now lenticels are those parts of the epidermis which are broken due to increased pressure happening, building up because of the secondary growth in the cortical region. So they help in aeration. And subsidiary cells are the cells which surround the stomata, and they are basically referred to as the accessory cells. So this is the correct matching for this match, for column 1 and column 2. So the correct answer would be option A. Okay, I hope it is synchronous with what I discussed with you. Then class 5, bicollateral vascular bundle. Usually we had learnt about collateral vascular bundle, where xylem is towards one side and phloem is in the same radius, and this is called conjoint collateral vascular bundle. But we see a different type of vascular bundle in some plants where xylem occupies a central position and there is phloem on both sides, and this type of vascular bundle is called bicollateral vascular bundle, which is a very important feature of family Cucurbitaceae. Poly R condition. Now, if you take a section of a root, for example, now if this is the section of the root, remember you've taken a section, so it appears spherical in outline, and in case of you have a central cylinder which is called the steel, within which you find the vascular bundle. Now, you all know in poly R condition there is more than 4 to 5 patches of xylem and phloem, so somewhat like this you can see the arrangement of the xylem and phloem in the case of the poly R condition. So where do you find this kind of a poly R condition? This is obviously seen in the case of monocot root. So the answer is monocot root. And did you all notice one more thing? Protoxylem is present towards the periphery and metaxylem is present towards the center. So what do you call this condition where in the steel the protoxylem occupies a peripheral position and the metaxylem occupies a central position? Do you recall? It is referred to as the exarch type of xylem arrangement. So there may be questions regarding this as well. So I'm telling it to you in the same slide. Remember, in a monocot root you find a poly R condition where there are more than 4 patches of xylem and phloem. So if you take a dicot root, you will ideally find about 2 to 4 patches. So we call the condition in dicot root as a tetrarch condition, but in monocot root we use the word poly R condition. Length of petiole increases due to, now petiole is the stalk of the leaf in which you will find a special type of meristem that is left behind by the growing axillary bud which grows into a leaf, and that is called intercalary meristem. Intercalary meristem is a primary meristem. If you remember, it is found to be intercalated with the mature tissue. These are left behind by the growing apical meristems which are found at the growing ends of the plant. Endodermis mainly helps in, now what does endodermis help in? It prevents the loss of water from the steel. Now endodermis, if you remember, especially the endodermis of a root, it has specialized waxy coating or a thickening which is referred to as the suberin, which will not allow the entry of water, and this basically brings about conservation of water. It prevents the loss of water from the steel. I hope you remember the suberized thickenings in the radial and the tangential wall of these endodermal cells are referred to as the Casparian strips. So please revise about the Casparian strips which are present in the endodermal cells in the radial and the tangential walls. Colenchyma is living and it contains protoplasm. That's why colenchyma is called as the living, what is it called? It is the living mechanical tissue. And hope you remember, colenchyma is not present in monocots and it is absent in dicot roots, okay? So colenchyma is living and contains protoplast is the correct answer. Meristematic tissues are those tissues which are premature. First of all, whenever I say premature, a tissue is considered to be premature when it is constantly dividing. Only after it stops dividing and it starts taking up the role or a particular function, then we call it as a mature or a differentiated tissue. But meristematic cells are premature, but and most importantly, they have a constant ability to divide. So the correct answer is option A. In the annual ring, the light colored part is referred to as the early wood. The early wood is also called as the spring wood. Now, I hope you remember that in the case of the dicot stem, there is an epidermis, and inner to the epidermis, there is a cortex, and then there is a wavy endodermis. So this region beneath the epidermis and the endodermis is referred to as the cortex. And I hope you know that there is a pericycle above the vascular bundle, which is made up of sclerenchyma. This is called the sclerenchymatous bundle cap, and then you have the conjoint collateral open vascular bundle. And we had also seen that in the vascular bundle, xylem is on the inside, phloem is on the outside, and there is a cambial tissue between the xylem and the phloem that is called intrafascicular cambium. During secondary growth, a new cambium is formed between the two, which is called interfascicular cambium. This forms a continuous ring which is referred to as the vascular cambium. I had told you that during the spring season, this particular cambium, so this is the cambium cambium tissue, which I'm writing at C over here. It puts out xylem vessels, which are very, very broader, which are less dense and lighter in color. And this happens during the spring season. However, during the autumn season, how are the xylem vessels put across? During the autumn season, the xylem vessels put out are somewhat very, very small in size, and they are more dense and they are darker in color. So we had called this patch, which has larger xylem vessels, which are very, very light in color and less dense, we had called them as the spring wood, or we had referred to them as the early wood, because they are formed in the spring season, that is the early time of the year. And this wood, which consists of smaller or narrower xylem vessels, we had called it as the autumn wood. And autumn wood is nothing but late wood, because it happens late in the year. So these two together, I had told you, these two together is referred to as the annual ring. So they are asking which in the annual ring, because this happens over a year. In a year, you have one spring season and one autumn season at the end of the year. So basically, the spring wood and the autumn wood collectively refers to or represents a patch or a ring of wood that is put out in one year. That's why it is called annual ring. And they're asking the light colored patch in this, it is the spring or the early wood. That's why the answer in this case is the spring or the early wood. Plant length is increased by, obviously, it is the apical meristem that is found at the growing ends of the plant, which increase the length of the plant. Of course, you also have to remember there may be intercalary meristem also, because if you see in monocot plants and in dicot plants, it is the intercalary meristem which increases the internode length. It increases the length of the internode. Obviously, if the length of the internode increases, then the plant length will also increase. So in the given options, it is apical meristem that happens to be the correct answer. In monocot roots, which type of vascular bundles are seen? Now, we had already discussed in the dicot root, I showed you about the polyarc bundle. So here in the monocot root also, we say that there is radial, and protoxylem is towards the periphery. So we call it as exarchoxylem. If you remember, if you take a section of the monocot root, you can see that there is a stele in the center. The central cylinder of tissue which lies within the endodermis is called the stele. In that, if you remember, there is xylem in four alternating patches with what in between? There is phloem in between. See how there is alternate patches of xylem and phloem. When there is alternate patches of xylem and phloem, the condition is said to be radial condition. And if you see the xylem, you can also remember that protoxylem is towards the periphery and metaxylem is towards the center. And this condition where protoxylem is towards the periphery is referred to as the exarch xylem. Okay. Interfascicular cambium, I had told you just now in the previous slide, we had seen how there is intrafascicular cambium already present between the xylem and the phloem, but a new cambium is formed between the two vascular bundles by the dedifferentiation of the radially arranged parenchymatous ray cells, and this is referred to as the interfascicular cambium. Casparian strip, I had told you, Casparian strip is found in the endodermis of dicot root, and this usually contains a suberized thickening. It's impermeable to water. It is a waxy substance that is referred to as the suberin. So now let us move on to a set of practice questions from the chapter Cell, the Unit of Life. An example for an enucleated plant living cell. Now, in a plant, of course, if the answer was animal, it would have been RPC. In plants, you have the sieve tube, which is very, very closely associated with, it's nothing but a component or an element of phloem tissue. You know that the sieve tube does not have a nucleus. It is maintained by the companion cell. The companion cell maintains the pressure gradients in the sieve tube, okay? Which is not an intracellular compartment. Now, among the following, the one that is not a compartment is referred to as the centriole or the centrosome. If you remember, there are two rod-shaped structures in the centriole which are placed at right angles to each other. If you take a section of this rod-shaped structure, if you remember, it has a cartwheel-like structure, isn't it? So this cartwheel-like structure is what we see in the case of centriole. And then each of these two are referred to as the diplosomes. And then there is a matrix surrounding it, which is called the pericentriolar material or the kinoplasm or the centroplasm, correct? So centriole is not a compartment. So therefore the answer is D. A plant cell differs from animal cell in the absence of, obviously, centrioles are absent in the case of plant cells. So how exactly the spindle fibers are formed in the plant cells? There is a research which suggests that there are certain microtubule organizing centers which start or initiate the spindle formation within the nuclear membrane, and those centers which are retained even after the disappearance of the nuclear membrane may help in the formation of the spindle apparatus in plants. The enzyme for electron transport system is located in the inner membrane of mitochondria. Very simple. You know that there is a network of complexes which are present within the inner mitochondrial membrane, starting from complex 1 to complex 5, which help in transfer of electrons, which is called the electron transporting chain or electron transporting system. Point out the wrong matching: mitochondria, respiration, blasted photosynthesis. Ribosome carbohydrates is a wrong option because ribosomes are the protein factories of the cell. So remember that ribosomes are not involved in carbohydrate synthesis, they are involved in protein synthesis. Which of the following observations strongly supports that mitochondria has electron transport system? Surprisingly, it is seen even if you disrupt the membrane of mitochondria, if you cause damage to it by carrying out a biochemical protocol. If you get the membrane pieces of the inner mitochondrial membrane, they have been identified to synthesize ATP in complete isolation, provided the right kind of reaction medium. This suggests that yes, it is mitochondria which has the electron transport system or the enzymes which are required. The ultimate goal is to synthesize ATP. Okay. Which lysosomes are scavenging in function? Now, the lysosomes which are scavenging, as in if there is any part of the cell that needs to be damaged, or like for example, the tail of a tadpole needs to disappear because its job is done. So the other tissues which are not required are degraded using this particular lysosome. Sometimes it can also cause a cell to commit suicide, and that's why these lysosomes, especially the answer is autolysosomes, which are the ones which kill the cell by digesting its own components, and that's why they are called as the suicidal bags. Secondary lysosomes should have. Now, secondary lysosomes are those. Now, for example, this is the cell which has just eaten its food. It has taken up the food or a solid particle. You know that this bulk transport of solid substances into the cell by a formation of an invagination of the cell membrane like this is referred to as phagocytosis. Now, after this invagination is completely pinched off from the plasma membrane, the food substance is placed inside a vacuole that is referred to as a phagosome, isn't it? Now this phagosome will unite with the already existing lysosome which contains enzymes in it. So lysosomes come off from the Golgi complex, and when the phagosome and the lysosome unite together, we get something which is called a heterophagosome, which is what is referred to as the secondary lysosome. And within the secondary lysosome, what do they have? You have food also which needs to be digested, and you have enzymes also. So as a result, the answer is it has both enzymes and food. If you say lysosome, it has enzyme only. So remember, lysosome is an offshoot of Golgi complex, so it contains enzyme only. And phagosome is formed by the pinching off of a phagocytic vesicle, and that is what is a pinching off of a plasma membrane, an invaginated plasma membrane. So this has only food in it. But a heterophagosome or a phagolysosome, so this secondary lysosome has alternate terms. It is called a heterophagosome, or it is called a phagolysosome. So it will obviously have both the enzyme as well as the food. Okay. Which one is incorrect with reference to lysosome? They are monomorphic and uniform in structure and function is incorrect, because just now we saw that lysosome keeps evolving. The moment it is produced from the Golgi complex, it is called primary lysosome, and then it is referred to as the heterophagosome. And then once the food is all digested and only the waste is present in it, it is called a residual body, which needs to be thrown out of the cell by ephagy or exocytosis. So there are so many different different forms of lysosome, and therefore the fact that it's mentioned that it is monomorphic or of a single form will be an incorrect statement as per the question. Okay. Glycolate metabolism occurs in peroxisome. Now in peroxisome there is an enzyme that is referred to as the glycolate oxidase, and this glycolate oxidase is used, or this glycolate oxidase takes part in a pathway which helps in the production of, from oxygen it produces something called hydrogen peroxide. However, the peroxisome, we had also learnt, it has another enzyme in it which is called the catalase enzyme, which will help in breaking down of hydrogen peroxide, because hydrogen peroxide is dangerous to the cell. So production of hydrogen peroxide within the peroxisome is because of an enzyme called glycolate oxidase. The marker enzyme for lysozyme is acid phosphatase, which helps in removal of phosphate groups from substances. It is mostly found in kidney and liver cells. It is very, very active. So this enzyme is universally found in lysosomes, and it can be used in detecting the lysosome and also identifying lysosome associated disorders in the system. Centriole is helpful in, obviously, it acts as microtubule organizing center, so it helps in spindle formation. Centrosome is a cytoplasmic structure which is found only in case of animal cells, because we had discussed earlier that cytoplasmic, the centrosome is not present in plant cells. So the second option is the correct answer. It is a cytoplasmic structure that is present only in animal cells. Nexin protein is found in microfilaments. If you all remember, we had seen that if this is the cilia or the flagella and it is emerging from the cell surface. Now this is the cell and this is the cilia or the flagella. If you take a section of the cilia or the flagella, you will find a structure that is a typical 9+2 arrangement. So you will find these 9 tube-like structures. 6, 7, 8, 9, isn't it? And then attached to these you will find incomplete tubule like structure. There's one complete doublet in the doublet and one is incomplete in the doublet, correct? Okay, each one of them are actually tube like or cylindrical structures. So remember, this is how the structure looks like if you take a transverse section of the cilia. Okay, so there are how many doublets which you can see in the peripheral region? You can see 9 microtubule doublets, and in the center you will have 2 microtubule singlets which are connected by a bridge which is made up of protein, and then there is a central sheath surrounding the singlet. That's why we say when you take a section, this entire structure that you see in the center of a cilia or a flagella is referred to as the axoneme, or it is referred to as the axial filament. Each tube-like structure here that you see is nothing but a microtubule. Okay, so this should not be a microfilament, it should be a microtubule. So now if you remember, in the microtubule, the wall of the microtubule is, I had told you, it is 25 nanometer in diameter, and in the wall you will find, so this is how a microtubule looks like, and you will find 13 serially arranged protein subunits, isn't it? Each proteins serially arranged protein filaments, which are called protofilaments. There are 13 of them. Each one has a repeating unit of alpha, beta tubulin dimers. Alpha, beta, which keep alternating with each other, and this protein which is found is referred to as the tubulin dimers. Now where is the nexin protein then? Now always remember, the A, this is, this complete microfilament is called the A tubule, and the complete microtubule is called the A tubule. The incomplete one is called the B tubule. The A tubule of one and the B tubule of the next is connected by a bridge, and this bridge is made up of a protein, and this protein is referred to as, so this is called a linker. So there is a linker present between the A microtubule and the B of the next one. Okay, so A to B. So again, A to B, See, there is a link present here throughout, and this is what is called the linker, and this linker is made up of what is referred to as the nexin protein. That's why the answer here is microtubule. Okay, I'm sorry, microfilaments, microtubule. Actually, the answer says cilia, which is absolutely true, but I have modified this. If it is microtubule, that is also correct, because microtubule makes up the cilia, but with respect to this, it is cilia or flagella, because I started off with the right thing. That is, when you take a section of the cilia or the flagella, you find the central core of the cilia or the flagella, that is referred to as the axoneme. So the answer to this is not microfilament or microtubule, it is cilia or flagella, which are the locomotory structures. Now I have written microtubule because both cilia and flagella are made up of a core. The core is nothing but comprising of microtubule. That's why I got confused here. So microtubule core is seen in both cilia and flagella. The plane of cell wall formation is entirely decided by microtubules, because it is the microtubules which are, suppose this is the plant cell, and after the plant cell divides, the microtubule or the spindle fibers will still remain, and these spindle fibers are nothing but microtubule, and they will trap certain vesicles at the middle of the cell, which are the Golgi vesicles, which will merge together to form the cell plate, which is nothing but the first step towards formation of the cell wall, and therefore the answer is microtubules. Okay, so now moving on to the next chapter, that is digestion and absorption. Let us discuss the questions from this chapter. The mesentery that covers most of the abdominal organs, extending inferiorly like an apron from the greater curvature of the stomach, is the greater omentum. First of all, mesentery is nothing but a mesodermal covering or a mesodermal layer. Okay, it is a mesodermal layer which is found in our abdominal cavity, and if this is the stomach, that is the lesser curvature, and this is the lesser curvature and the greater, this mesentery is known to extend down the greater curvature of the stomach like a curtain, and it covers all the organs. Behind the curtain you will find the small intestine, the large intestine. So this membrane, the mesodermal membrane, which emerges from the greater curvature of the stomach, is referred to as the omentum, the greater omentum. Okay, which selection does not correctly pair with the type of tooth and its description? So the first one itself is not correct, because incisors, they have one root only, they do not have two roots. Okay, if this is an incisor, it has a spoon shaped structure, and beneath the gum line it has only one single root by which it is anchored to the alveoli, which is nothing but the jaw socket. So the first one is not a correct pair. From deep to superficial, which are the tunics or the layers of the intraperitoneal or the wall of the gastrointestinal tract? They're asking from inside to the outside. Deep to superficial means inside. You know that inside is the lumen. Now what is lumen? Lumen is where the food passes. So on the inside you have what is referred to as the lumen. Which is the layer closest to the lumen? It is mucosa. So inner mucosa, outer to that is submucosa, outer to that is muscularis externa, and the outermost mesothelium or the squamous cell layer, which is very very thin, is called as the serosa. In which of the following selections are GI tract organs and regions correctly matched with the type of epithelium covering them? So it is the cecum, that is the first part of the large intestine, the colon, the broader parts of the three types, ascending, transverse and descending, and rectum, which is the part where temporarily the excreta is stored, and all of them are lined on the inside by simple columnar epithelium, and this is the correct matching option among all of them. Within the mucous membrane of the GI tract, the layer of areolar connective tissue, I had told you that in the GI tract, the innermost wall, if this is the wall of your intestine, and the innermost wall is thrown into finger-like projections, which are referred to as villi. This is the lumen through which the food is passing, and this is the outside. So this villi, inside the villus, if you remember, inside the villus, we had discussed that there is a lymph vessel. The lymph vessel is called lacteal. We had also discussed that there are capillary networks that are present inside, and these capillary networks which have arteriole and venule in them, and the entire space within the villus is covered by areolar connective tissue. The name of this areolar connective tissue that fills the space between the villi, which forms a part of the mucosa, is referred to as the lamina propria. Which tunic of the GI tract typically contains an inner circular and outer longitudinal? Obviously, it is muscularis externa, and between the two muscle layers there is a network of neurons which is referred to as the myenteric or the Auerbach's plexus. So it is muscularis externa. The intestine is 29 feet long because the greater the length, there is greater food digestion and absorption. You basically want to increase the surface area. Crypts of Lieberkens secrete succus entericus, which is nothing but the intestinal juice. Remember, the crypts of Lieberkens are the depressions between the villi that are found in the inner wall of the small intestine. So they are the ones that secrete intestinal juice, which is called succus entericus. Which of these terms is used for two different parts applied with a slight difference in its spelling? That is ileum. If I say ileum, it is basically a part of the intestine, the third part of the intestine. If you want to refer to the ileum bone of your hip region, then you write it as ileum. So ileum is a bone. Okay, so ileum with a I is a bone of your hip region, which is the coxal bone. Ileum with an E is the last part of your small intestine. Okay. Brunner's glands are found in the submucosa of the duodenum. They secrete enormous amounts of alkaline mucus. During prolonged starvation, obviously your body is going to use the energy source, which is in the form of subcutaneous fat. Which amino acid is denoted by symbol F? It is phenylalanine. It is an aromatic amino acid. Castle's intrinsic factor, remember, Castle's intrinsic factor is secreted by the gastric. Now tell me, which is the cell in the gastric gland which secretes this particular Castle's intrinsic factor? You have the auxintic or the parietal cells, isn't it? The auxintic or the parietal cells are the cells which secrete this particular factor, which is referred to as the Castle's intrinsic factor, which is required for the absorption of vitamin B12 in your intestine. Beauty vitamin is vitamin E because vitamin E has anti-aging properties. That's why it is referred to as the beauty vitamin. Curdling of milk, that is specifically an enzyme that acts on milk protein casein. So which is the enzyme that acts on milk protein casein? Renin with a double N. I had told you that there is a renin with a single N, which is the hormone of your kidney. In this case, a renin with a double N is the enzyme of your stomach. Okay, moving on to the last chapter for practice questions, that is breathing and exchange of gases. Which of the following increases oxygen affinity? Which of the following is responsible for oxygen and hemoglobin becoming best friends? Now, the most important factor among the given options is high blood pH, that is alkaline conditions. When the blood pH is very high, as in the case of alveoli, in the tissues the blood pH drops because of increased H plus concentration due to carbon dioxide concentration. Isn't it? So here the high blood pH is the one that helps hemoglobin and oxygen to become best friends, that is to them to be bound to each other. Therefore we say it increases the oxygen affinity of hemoglobin. So it is the both B and C, they have said low partial pressure of carbon dioxide. Yes, so high blood pH, I told you, is a direct relationship of low partial pressure of carbon dioxide, which is also seen in the alveoli. So this is also at alveoli. So yes, it is not just C, it is both B and C. Bohr effect. Now where does hemoglobin and oxygen become enemies? Now hemoglobin and oxygen, which were together until now in the form of oxyhemoglobin, they decide to part ways. Hemoglobin gets separated from oxygen and oxygen goes off to the tissues. They bid goodbye to each other, and this happens because of high partial pressure of carbon dioxide in the tissue, and this is the influence of carbon dioxide on oxy. Why do they dissociate? Why do they become enemies? Because there is high partial pressure of carbon dioxide in the tissues. This effect is referred to as the Bohr's effect. So it is effect of PCO2 on oxyhemoglobin, where they become enemies, they split away from each other. During transport of carbon dioxide, blood doesn't become acidic because of blood buffers. Hemoglobin is the best buffer available, isn't it? Because hemoglobin itself combines with the free protons or H plus ion, and it forms a substance that is called hydroxyhemoglobin. Therefore, it traps the H plus ion. Specifically, which amino acid in hemoglobin? There is an amino acid that is called histidine, and histidine is very good at attaching or binding to this proton and therefore acting as a buffer. So the answer is blood buffers, which is why the blood doesn't become too acidic. Chloride shift is essential for the transport of carbon dioxide. We saw that during the transport of carbon dioxide, chloride shift happens at the tissue level. I had told you that in the tissue level, inside the RBCs, what happens is bicarbonate comes out and chloride goes in, and this exchange is referred to as chloride shift. Chloride shift is also called the Hamburger's phenomenon. Okay, the largest quantity of air that can be expired after maximum inspiratory effort is vital capacity. So what is vital capacity? Tidal volume plus inspiratory reserve volume plus expiratory reserve volume. But the actual textbook definition is not given over here. How do you define the vital capacity? It is important to note that it is the maximum volume of air that can be forcibly inhaled or inspired after forcible expiration. So this is the actual definition given in the NCRT. Now, for example, you forcibly expire. What all are you giving out? You're giving out tidal volume. You are giving out ERV. What is left in your lung? Only RV is left. So you have ensured that only RV is left now. After that, what are you doing? You are forcibly inspiring. So what all is entering into your lungs when you forcibly inspire? First, tidal volume is going in. Because you are forcefully inspiring, you are taking in inspiratory reserve volume. Because you had given away ERV, you have to restore that ERV now. And already RV is there. So tidal volume plus IRV plus ERV, all of them enter your lung. That is immediately after you forcibly expire, followed by forcible inspiration. So the maximum volume of air that can be forcibly inspired after forcible expiration is referred to as the vital capacity. Okay, so the correct answer is option C. Blood analysis of a patient reveals very high quantity of carboxyhemoglobin. Carboxyhemoglobin is a byproduct of combination of a very, very poisonous, and this is irreversible. It leads to complete oxygen deprivation. It can be fatal also. So it is due to the inhalation of carbon monoxide. Respiratory quotient is defined by it's given by an equation, that is the volume of carbon dioxide given out, that is what we breathe out, and the volume of oxygen that we take in. So this is what is referred to as the respiratory quotient. Which of the following conditions is responsible for increase in ventilation of lungs? That means when do you breathe more? Ventilation rate means breathing rate. Normally you breathe about 12 to 14 times in a minute, isn't it? So which among the following will make you breathe more, they are saying. So obviously it would be increased carbon dioxide content of the air, because when you are breathing more carbon dioxide in the blood, the partial pressure of carbon dioxide will increase, and the H plus ion concentration will increase, and there will be a drastic fall in the pH. All these will trigger which center in your brain? It will trigger the dorsal respiratory group, which is a very important center in your medulla oblongata, which is called the inspiratory area, or it's called the inspiratory center. And what this inspiratory center will do? It will send signals to which part of your lungs or which part of your body, to your ribs and to your diaphragm, allowing them to contract. And if they contract, both your ribs muscles, that is intercostal muscles, and your diaphragm contract, that means your you will take in air, that means you will inhale, isn't it? So if you inhale more, you will exhale more, and your breathing rate will overall increase. So it is increase in carbon dioxide content of the inhaled air. The blue baby syndrome is due to a condition called methemoglobia. In normal hemoglobin, all of you remember, the iron that is present is in Fe2 plus form. But if this Fe2 plus form gets oxidized into Fe3 plus form, we call this abnormal hemoglobin as methemoglobin. And this will lead to very, very poor binding of oxygen by hemoglobin. Hemoglobin will lose its affinity to oxygen, and therefore the body tissues of the baby will become blue in color, and this is seen when there is nitrate poisoning. Now, in the drinking water, if there is nitrate, and then if the child consumes this kind of a nitrate contaminated water, the nitrate is responsible for oxidation of Fe2 plus to Fe3 plus, and this condition is referred to as methemoglobinemia. Okay. People living at sea level have 5 million RBCs, whereas those at an altitude at 5400 meters have so much more RBCs in them. That is because the air is thinner, the atmospheric oxygen level is less, not less, but it diffuses less because the air pressure outside, the atmospheric pressure falls, and therefore you need more RBCs to compensate for the thinner air or the less pressure that you see in the case of the higher altitude areas. That's why in higher altitude people have more amount of RBCs in their blood. Protective respiratory blast, a sudden blast of exhalation, is nothing but sneezing. It's a protective mechanism. It is a reflex action to throw out any irritating chemical that must have entered your nasal cavity. Pneumotaxic center, I had told you, is located in the pons. The pneumotaxic center inhibits, please remember, it sends negative signals to the dorsal respiratory group. In the previous slide, I told you the dorsal respiratory group has inspiratory neurons. Now, when it sends negative signals to inspiratory neurons, you will inhale less. And when you inhale less, what will happen? You will basically, it will alter the breathing rate. It's not that you will inhale less, it will reduce the duration of inhalation. So reduces the, so if you're breathing very, very deeply, then you will breathe less number of times in a minute. But if you're breathing very short, that is, if your inhalation is for a very short duration, then you will breathe more number of times. So it reduces the duration of inhalation, and that's why it is going to alter the breathing rate of the person. And this is the job of the pneumotaxic center, okay, located in the pons veruli. Which of the following amino acid acts, as I had told you, histidine, which is an aromatic amino acid. It has a ring in it, which is very, very important in accepting proton, and it acts as a blood buffer in hemoglobin. If RQ is less than 1, if it's less than 1, that means you all know that RQ is the volume of carbon dioxide that you are evolving by volume of oxygen that you are basically consuming. So this is what is RQ. When can this value be less than 1? When the denominator is lesser and the numerator is, when the numerator is lesser and the denominator is more. That means you are giving out less of carbon dioxide, but you are consuming more of oxygen. Okay. So what does this, it would mean that the oxidation of the respiratory substrate is consuming more oxygen, but it is not giving out more carbon dioxide. So it is the last option. Remember, the numerator is volume of carbon dioxide released by the volume of oxygen consumed, is called the respiratory quotient. What is true about RBCs in humans? The correct statement would be they carry about 20 to 25% of carbon dioxide, but the statement is still very ambiguous because it should be mentioned that they carry 20 to 25% of carbon dioxide in combination of hemoglobin to form a compound called carbaminohemoglobin. So this completes the practice questions for this week's crash course. 4 major chapters we have covered. So I hope you all study well and do well in your crash course. Thank you.